I would like to take this opportunity right at the start of the video to let you know that I need your help to keep running this channel. I'll be completely honest and transparent with you. I am back, yes, but with nothing in my pockets. That is, other than the excitement, determination, and trust that with your help, I will make this happen. I have got so much to give, so many ideas to share. YouTube is an amazing platform which enables me to reach such a wide audience, to put my thoughts out there. It enables me to share my gifts, my uniqueness with the world. And what I do always comes from my heart. That's the way I am, always have been. I can't help it. I just don't have a business mind, and inevitably the practical and monetary aspects of life do tend to get in the way. A video such as this one takes at the very least 2 weeks of hard work to create, and I want to keep working on my videos, but I need to create the necessary changes in the next few weeks to make this dream a reality. Let me clarify that my videos are and will always remain free. Financial contribution is completely voluntary. But if you value what I do and you think I deserve to be rewarded for my work and it is within your financial capabilities to help me out, I kindly ask you to consider becoming one of my patrons via Patreon or contributing a one-time donation via PayPal. I have set my first milestone goal at $500 per video. This will pay for my groceries and some of my bills. It is a start as it will cover the basics, and that is what is most needed right now. Whether you decide to contribute financially or not, I am incredibly grateful for having you as a subscriber and for any support that you can offer, financial or otherwise. From the bottom of my heart, thank you ever so much for being here and for taking the time to listen to this message. The content of this video starts now. Buckle your seatbelt and I hope you enjoy the ride. What is knowledge? How do we learn stuff? Can we ever be absolutely certain that we know something? What are the limits of our understanding? How do we learn about ourselves and the world around us? Is science and rational thinking the most reliable path to knowledge? What about intuition? And what about introspection? What is the most effective path to self-knowledge and personal growth? And what does Gödel, mysticism and magic mushrooms got to do with it? A few weeks ago, I signed up to a couple of meetups, which will be held later on this month in the city where I live, here in the UK. The title of the meetups is What is Knowledge? And the group is called Café Philo, short for Café Philosophique, which was originally founded in France in 1992. Nowadays, there are hundreds of Café Philos around the world, gatherings of inquisitive minds, groups of individuals meeting in a pub or café discussing philosophical subjects for fun, to socialize and just meet like-minded people, I guess. I'm really excited because I have never been to this kind of meetup before, and I hope it's going to be really interesting and rewarding. And it will get me out of the house in the evening, which is not easy to do, being a single mum and student trying to juggle way too many things at the same time. So yeah, I'm really excited, very much looking forward to that. So, in preparation for my meetups, a few weeks ago I started pondering about the subject. It got me thinking and thinking and thinking a little bit more. I read and reread some bits here and there, from books to articles. I also watched some videos. I actually even bought some new books, such as this one, which I have wanted to read for such a long time. I've just received it on the post this week, but haven't had a chance to get past the intro yet. So once I have read a few chapters, I am sure that it will provide food for thought for future videos. After doing a little research and some thinking, I finally came up with a few ideas, which, me being me, I guess they are a little less conventional, a little bit more edgy than your average epistemology YouTube video. So, we will talk about knowledge, but with a rather unconventional spin on it. And of course, I would like to give credit where it's due, because a large portion of my inspiration for this particular video came from a few paragraphs in this rather obscure, unknown book called Bridging Science and Spirit by Norman Friedman. I just love the book, so much food for thought. And of course, lots of fascinating fringe ideas in it. You will find all the links in the description box below the video. And just a quick note to say that this video will be split into three parts, which I'm going to upload to YouTube separately. Right now you're watching part one. Okay, let's get started. I'll begin with a little introduction to Kurt Gödel and his incompleteness theorem. I think this man was a genius, and I feel it's a shame that the general population does not know anything about him, because his ideas apply to all areas of life, not just mathematics, science, logic, or some abstract idea of human knowledge in general. In fact, I feel very strongly that the very core of Gödel's ideas can be applied to everyday life itself, to personal growth, to our curiosity about the nature of reality, the nature of consciousness. They can be applied to our understanding of the personal limitations we encounter as human beings every day when we try to make sense of what is happening to us, of our behavior, of our relationships, or the events happening in the world around us. In 1931, at the tender age of 25, Austrian mathematician Kurt Gödel published a paper titled The Incompleteness Theorem, with far-reaching philosophical implications, which apply to all formal systems of knowledge. I think that Gödel's theorem is unquestionably among the most important theorems ever formulated. So, without further ado, let's get to the meat of it. The theorem states that within any rigidly logical mathematical system, there are propositions or questions that cannot be proved or disproved on the basis of the axioms within that system, and therefore it is uncertain that the basic axioms of arithmetic will not give rise to contradictions. Now, this is actually a bit too technical for what I've got in mind right now for this video, so let me rephrase it as a very simple statement, one which still encapsulates the essence of the theorem while making it easier to understand from a non-mathematical perspective. Here it goes. Any system, anything which you can draw a circle around, cannot completely explain itself without referring to something else outside the circle it is surrounded with. This something else outside the circle needs to be assumed, but cannot be proven. If the system tries to explain itself from within the confines of the circle, then contradictions or paradoxes may arise, which is an inevitable consequence of the self-referential nature of the system which is trying to explain itself. Let's focus on the importance of this for a moment, because it is basically saying that any formal system of knowledge can only produce truth statements which are not provable within the confines of the system itself. Think about what this really means. Well, among other things, it means that mathematics can fail. It means that science cannot prove everything. It means that self-reference and paradox is an intrinsic and inevitable part of life. It means that we can only ever hope to gain partial understandings. It means that our knowledge will always be incomplete. It means that intuition and reason are both equally important. It means that there is no such thing as a closed system explaining itself. It means that there is no closure. It means that anything that is objectified, confined within boundaries, cannot satisfactorily understand itself without transcending these boundaries, or at least make assumptions about what might be outside the boundaries. It means that the universe needs to somehow transcend itself in order to fully understand itself. It means that you can always draw a bigger circle, and that even then, you will still have to assume there is something else outside that bigger circle. It means that this drawing of bigger circles never ends, because the wider context of a bigger circle is subject to the incompleteness theorem as well. And again, it would need to be viewed from the perspective of a wider circle in order to be fully understood. And this defines a seemingly infinite spectrum of circles, a spectrum of perspectives or levels in which each level includes and transcends the level below it. It basically means that there is no completion, that there is no end to growth, understanding and knowledge. As Terence McKenna said, no program of formal analysis will ever completely exhaust its subject. There will always be a residuum of mystery, and we need to come to terms with this. I think this is so exciting. I mean, think about it. How boring would reality be otherwise? Gödel's theorem states that, beyond a certain level of complexity, there are intrinsic limits to the truths that can be established from within a given system. However, if we can somehow transcend the system, that is, view it from a wider perspective, or from the outside, as it were, the original system statements can be provable. But then again, the new wider perspective can only establish half-baked truths, because it is also subject to the same restrictions. In this way, as human beings, we can only ever hope to gain a partial understanding of our universe. At least from the perspective of science, currently we can only attempt to explain it from within. We are not only connected to what we are measuring, but we are part of what we are measuring. From a wider perspective, I would say that what we are measuring is part of us. We inevitably find ourselves trapped in what is apparently true, in paradoxes within paradoxes. Certainty, proof, and absolute knowledge are forever out of our grasp. I love how beautifully Mark Archer expressed this same thought in a recent comment on Cracking the Nutshell's Facebook page. He wrote, "It seems to me that there is and always will be mystery at the edges of our knowledge and perception. We are encapsulated in a mystery, within a riddle, within a conundrum. That is the nature of the universe, for us humans at least. It is a myth, a story. Whichever form of inquiry you take, it seems you will eventually find the mystery, the unfathomable and unknowable. It is at this point that the universal story seems to be telling the inquirer to change his eyes, his vision, his way of thinking." A really cool video by Carl Sagan has come to my mind now, where he explains the idea of flatland, a two-dimensional land designed and named by Edwin Abbott. In the video, you can see Carl Sagan using an apple as a way to illustrate the impossibility of gaining complete knowledge of a three-dimensional world from the limited perspective of a two-dimensional being. I will put a link in the description box. It's such a lovely video, a classic not to be missed. For now, here is a lovely passage taken from Flatland, the actual book itself, which beautifully illustrates the idea of this two-dimensional geometrical being suddenly finding itself transcending to a new sphere of existence, experiencing a three-dimensional world for the first time, seeing Flatland from a perspective no other flat being had seen before, therefore gaining knowledge which was previously completely inaccessible to him. Here it goes. "An unspeakable horror seized me. There was a darkness, then a dizzying sensation of sight that was not like seeing. I saw space that was not space. I was myself and not myself. I shrieked, 'Either this is madness or it is hell.' 'It is neither,' replied the voice of the sphere. 'It is knowledge. It is three dimensions. Open your eye once again and try to look steadily.' I looked, and behold, a new world." It's such a wonderful little passage, isn't it? It illustrates wonderfully the idea of gaining new knowledge through transcendence. Now, and this is where I'm heading with the rest of this video, particularly in parts 2 and 3, think of the idea of the self. The age-old question we all ask ourselves at some point or another. Who am I? Have you ever wondered, could we be like Mr. Square in Flatland? Is it possible that we are actually a lot more than we thought we were? Is this physical reality all there is? Or is there another larger reality which includes it and transcends it? Something analogous to Flatland's mystical dimension called up or down? Something we can't even fathom from our current limited perspective. What are we? Who are we from the perspective of a higher dimensional sphere of existence? And if there are higher dimensional spheres of existence, is it possible for us to gain knowledge about them? Well, I say, why not start with self-knowledge? Think about it. How is it obtained? One can argue that subjective experience, self-exploration, is the most important tool, that it is at the root of it all. If you think about it, it is in fact the only tool we have to gain knowledge, the only way for us to attain new levels of understanding. And the reality is that, as Gödel very elegantly pointed out, we can only ever find partial truths, paradoxical understandings, which we may be able to refine with self-growth, which is nothing but the continuous expansion of the idea of who we really are, an expansion of our identity, an expansion of the boundaries we surround ourselves with. In other words, we need to learn how to transcend ourselves in order to gain a better understanding of ourselves. And this process of transcendence is a never-ending process. The beauty of it is that it goes ad infinitum. And don't forget, our understanding of the self is intimately interconnected with our understanding of what we define as the outside world, that is, what we conceive as being outside ourselves, the not-self. Where we draw the boundary between self and not-self will determine the type of knowledge we gain about ourselves and the universe. And of course, here is where mysticism comes in. I do feel that rational thinking is overrated. I think that there are many valid paths to knowledge, or useful in some way or another in our quest to find truth, or shall we say partial truths. Which leads me to Wittgenstein. He had the idea that philosophy should not be about finding truth, but finding statements which are true enough. As Gödel pointed out, true enough is as close to the truth we can ever get. That is, if there is anything such as absolute truth. And this, of course, applies not only to philosophy, maths, or science, but most importantly, it applies to life, our experience, our desire to understand, our self-growth, and our spiritual paths. As physicist Paul Davies once said, while referring to the implications of Gödel's theorem, we are barred from ultimate knowledge, from ultimate explanation, by the very rules of reasoning that prompt us to seek such an explanation in the first place. If we wish to progress beyond, we have to embrace a different concept of understanding from that of rational explanation. Possibly the mystical path is the way to such understanding. Maybe mystical insights provide the only route beyond the limits to which science and philosophy can take us, the only possible path to the ultimate. Makes you think, doesn't it? So, what are mystical insights then?